Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter addressed the people, "You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out." The word of the Lord.
Defender of my cause, you set me free. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. When the disciples were telling how they had seen Jesus risen from the dead, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I speak to you in the name of one God, creator, redeemer, and sustainer. Amen. On Tuesday, I had the chance to go see the Lakers play the Warriors at Crypto Arena. And before you even ask, yes, I am a Warriors fan. But as my friends and I hung around after the game and watched some of the players give post-game interviews, I was reminded of how Steph Curry, one of the very famous Warriors players, will sometimes conclude his interviews by saying, "All glory to God," before running off into the locker room to go and join his teammates. Now, I have to be honest, I usually cringe when professional athletes say something religious after games, mostly because I don't think God really cares about who wins or loses a sporting match. But in this particular case, Steph Curry got me thinking about how we bear witness to God in our lives. A priest friend of mine used to say that he tried to envision everything that he did as a clergy person as giving glory to God, even those difficult and challenging aspects of the vocation. Famous artists like Johann Sebastian Bach and George Frederick Handel used to signify that their music was produced for giving praise to God by writing "Soli Deo Gloria," to God the glory alone, at the end of every piece of music they wrote. In our liturgy, we often sing the Gloria in Excelsis, glory to God, at the beginning of our services, bearing witness to God in and through our lives is an important aspect of what it means to be a Christian. The gospel story we hear this morning aims to provide reassurance to the disciples amidst their confusion and fear, and it also commissions them to go out into the world bearing witness to the work of God, to preach the gospel, if you will. Now, you may have noticed that there is a particular focus on Jesus's earthly body in our gospel story this morning. And this serves a point. It helps not only to assuage the fear and disbelief of the disciples, who thought that they were seeing a ghost, pretty scary stuff, but it also represents Jesus as an embodied person, alive and beyond the grave. It indicates the continuity between Jesus' life before the crucifixion and his existence after the resurrection. Death cannot contain Jesus and those things that Jesus does. And we hear that upon returning to his disciples, Jesus greets them with the words, "Peace be with you." It's a phrase that communicates a wish for communal well-being, very much related to the Hebrew notion of shalom. And in Luke's gospel, it's also used as a way to communicate salvation, God's goodness and God's grace towards us. Even after the crucifixion, Jesus continues to reconcile. He continues to offer God's salvation. He continues to empower his disciples to offer forgiveness of sins to all nations. The risen Christ appears to the disciples to assure them that he lives and to help them see the bigger picture. Jesus opens the disciples' minds to the work that God has been doing all along. From the beginning of his gospel, Luke the evangelist tells us that Jesus is the fulfillment of God's plan of redemption for all of creation. In our lesson this morning, it all comes full circle. In appearing to his disciples, Jesus demonstrates God's ability to turn the ugliness of the crucifixion into the transforming power of the resurrection. What the disciples see in Jesus' resurrected body is God's ability to bring new life out of death. Jesus' whole life and ministry, his dying and his rising, are all about what God has been doing from the very beginning, reconciling the world to God's self. All the writings from the Old Testament, from the laws of Moses, the Psalms, the prophets, have been about God and God's purposes for creation. Nothing, not even death, will prevent God from seeking to be in relationship with creation. Nothing can stop God from being God. And yet, the world remains oppressive and inhospitable for many. There is war, there is famine, there is a climate crisis, political polarization, violence, and suffering still very much exist in our world. I recently came across a piece of writing by an Episcopal scholar who suggested that so much of our brokenness, so much of the violence in our world today comes from what we might call this us versus them mentality. He pointed out that every conflict relies on individuals surrendering their morality to what he calls this mob rule mentality. We hear Peter, in the first lesson we heard earlier from Acts, address this kind of mob rule mentality. As Peter preaches in Acts, he uses the second person plural to address the crowd. He doesn't single out individuals from the crowd that called for Jesus' crucifixion, but rather he speaks of a group as a whole that failed to do the right thing. He's saying, y'all rejected Jesus. Y'all rejected the holy and righteous one. And this mob rule mentality that Peter speaks against can hijack our morality and can lead to the dehumanization of the other. There have been all sorts of atrocities throughout history where violence has been perpetrated against the outgroup because of this kind of mentality. Think of the Holocaust or lynch mobs preying on Black Americans, violence committed against our LGBTQ siblings, cyberbullying in this day and age. But Jesus comes to his disciples this morning offering another way that frees us from the ways of violence and the mob rule. In the gospel today, Jesus shows the disciples his resurrected body and opens their minds to understand that nothing will prevent God from being God. Jesus tells his followers that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations. Nothing will ever stop God from trying to free us from those things that separate us from one another and from God. And when we allow ourselves to bask in God's grace, God's love that never, ever leaves us, our perception of the world and our relationships begin to shift. We begin to see the world the way God sees the world. We begin to see that the brokenness in our world and the people around us and in our lives does not have the final word. Jesus commissions his disciples to proclaim that tragedy, despair, and death are not ultimate. God is. Nothing will ever stop God from working to redeem the world. God, the giver of life and mercy, is ever ready to offer shalom so that peace, well-being, and order and hope might prevail. Jesus offers his presence to his disciples as they break bread together so that they might bear witness to these things. He reminds his disciples and us that our true identity is grounded in a divine love, and not even the darkest days or our darkest impulses will prevent God from helping us to realize this. All glory be to God. Amen.
Saying the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ. God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified.
Let us praise the name of the Lord. The promises of God are trustworthy and true, so let us pray, loving God, make all things new. Loving Creator, your Son Jesus commands us to love one another as he loves us. Help us to do as he commands. Give your church the will to seek and serve Christ in all persons. Loving God, make all things new. Gracious God, you bless the world in your incarnation. Come and make your home with us. Bring an end to war, strife, and dominance among nations. Establish your reign of peace on earth as it is in heaven. Loving God, make all things new. Glorious Lord, you created the heavens and the earth and all there is therein. At your command, all things came into being. Give us ears to hear the praise coming forth from the world. Give us eyes to see your glory reflected in your creation. May our voices join the song of creation. Loving God, make all things new. God of comfort, behold and visit, we pray, the cities of the earth that our neighborhoods and communities might become more like your heavenly city. Enable us to eliminate poverty, prejudice, and oppression, that peace may prevail with righteousness and justice with order. Loving God, make all things new. Mighty God, wipe every tear from the eyes of your children. We pray for those who are in any need or trouble. Come with healing, come with strength, and come to your people. Loving God, make all things new. Alpha and Omega, we long for the day when you will make all things new. We long for the day when death will be no more, when mourning and crying and pain will be no longer. In our longing, we trust in the power of your love and ask you to shine your light on those we love but see no longer, and to comfort those in mourning, grief, or despair. And lead us all in the way of everlasting life. Loving God, make all things new.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever. Amen." Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Greet one another with the sign of Christ's peace. Good morning. Welcome to St. Cross. Welcome if you're new or a regular. Thank you for joining us despite all this rain. We pray that you are all safe and dry and make it back to your homes to be comfortable. A few quick signs of Christ's love in our community. First, happening right now, part of our youth group is participating in a beach cleanup day organized by the South Bay Congregations Against Hate, which is a group that, of the South Bay of interfaith congregations that came about to be to respond to hate crimes against religious institutions. And if you would be interested in participating in more events and helping us be joined with that good work, please reach out to me, Reverend Josh, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that organization. Also happening today is Faith at Five, a dinner service where we have dinner and discuss the day's gospel and reflect on the sermon and do worship and community life together a little bit differently. Please join us at 5 p.m. today in Parker Hall. There is another wedding to be had. Our very own Larry Johnson is getting married right here. He'll be center stage. You're welcome to join us next this Saturday, April 20th at 4 p.m. Then the next Saturday is our big 5K walk that we're participating in to raise money and awareness for pancreatic cancer research and patient services. Our beloved co-worker and friend Dave Dawson, who was a sexton here for 5 years, succumbed to the disease, and we're walking to remember and honor him. So if you'd like to join the team, please reach out to the office. There's a link on our Facebook page and in the weekly email. We'd love to have you join us in the walk or donate money on behalf of our team from St. Cross. Our next baptism is on May 19th, so if you or someone in your family is interested in baptism, please reach out to Reverend Stephen. And also, if you are interested in Vacation Bible School, for kids from age in kindergarten to fifth graders, also reach out to Reverend Stephen. On Wednesday, April 24th, there's a SAC lunch, and the guest speaker is our very own Reverend Bob Corner, who will be speaking about the spirituality of elderhood. One of the great traditions of St. Cross is when someone leaves our community, we invite them forward and say a prayer and offer them a blessing as they leave, or maybe they're moving. And we had a member of our community, Carol Grimes, who has moved, and we did not get a chance to send her away with a blessing. She moved to be closer with her family so they could take better care of her. If you would be interested in and so kind to send her a note card to say welcome to her new home and that we miss you and we love you and we're praying for you, please reach out to me or Bitsy Lutton and we'll send you her new address so you can send her a card and let her know that you're thinking of her. And last and most importantly, we ask for your prayers. Please pray for us, your clergy and staff. Pray for Reverend Rachel as she's taking a month of sabbatical this summer to make up for her missed sabbatical last summer. And pray for one another. People who have asked for prayers are listed in the back of your bulletin. And if you would like to be included on that list, please fill out a prayer card or send us an email or fill out a website form. It is a great honor and privilege to be with you in prayer, and we would love to lift up whatever concern is close to your heart and be with you in prayer. Thank you. Have a great week.
Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom, and you are exalted as head over all.
Thank you.
Give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to You, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise You for the glorious resurrection of Your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For He is a true Paschal Lamb who is sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By His death He has destroyed death, and by His rising to life again, He has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise You, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of Your name. Holy and gracious Father, in Your infinite love You made us for Yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, You in Your mercy sent Jesus Christ, Your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature and to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to You, the God and Father of all. He stretched out His arms upon the cross and offered Himself in obedience to Your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night He was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when He had given thanks to You, He broke it and gave it to His disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is My body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of Me." After supper, He took the cup of wine. And when He had given thanks, He gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is My blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of Me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling His death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer to You these gifts. Sanctify them by Your Holy Spirit to be for Your people the body and blood of Your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in Him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve You in unity, constancy, and peace, and at the last day bring us with all Your saints into the joy of Your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through Your Son, Jesus Christ. By Him and with Him and in Him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is Yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ in the universe could not contain is present to us in this bread. Jesus, who redeemed us and calls us by name, now meets us in this cup. Take this bread and this wine. In them, God comes to us so that we may come to God. God, Creator and Redeemer, we give this foretaste of your glory. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. God of peace, by whose glory Christ was raised from the dead, strengthening you to walk with Jesus in his risen life, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let us go forth in the name of Christ.